Good afternoon, right, almost, oh, actually right now. What we're going through today is actually a case study that we at Kargo did with both LG and Hershey's. This is actually Hershey's first true interactive campaign. Pretty exciting. And I'll show you what it looks like actually on glass, which is really pretty unique and novel. You probably haven't seen something like this before, and it's sort of the future of what we think TV glass advertising will look like. So to sort of jump right into it, my name is Harry Kargman. I'm the founder and CEO of Kargo. We've been around for over 20 years. This is our 20th anniversary. We power about 1 billion ad impressions on a monthly basis. We see that in our exchange, actually 100 billion, and we're now integrated into a number of different TV manufacturers as well as into different streaming services with the idea that we can bring these incredible, high-impact, beautiful experiences onto the screen of the television set. And so this is really a showcase of probably one of the first campaigns ever that have been on screen, and we're going to take you through a little bit of a case study around that. The key takeaway and outcome that I want to sort of have you take a look at is the performance that you can garner by seeing what it looks like actually on the TV screen. So let's start with what's happening today. Right now, what we see is that there's this massive change from broadcast to CTV viewing. You see that with Netflix, you see it with Amazon Prime, you see it with Disney, et cetera. And with this change and adaptation of viewing habits, what you see is a totally different medium that allows for much better targeting, much higher impact creatives, and just a different kind of result that you can get out of standard broadcast TV. What we see is 93% of households have access to that connected television. So when we think about connectedness, what we're really talking about is the difference between what connected TV can drive from an outcomes perspective versus that of broadcast. And just the ability to segment households, which I think is incredibly important. In broadcast TV, you really can't do that. There's an ability to tailor ads to geography, which again, truly differentiated, and broadcast, you can't really do that. You can do some segmenting, but it's really not geo-targeted towards specific households in neighborhoods or closer to, for example, specific retail stores. And you can dynamically personalize the messaging to allow for a different level of engagement. And I think that is something that we're just starting at the forefront to explore. So instead of broadcast ads just going the same ad everywhere across nationally all at once, what you're really talking about is a sea change in how you target consumers or households on specific devices in a much more narrow cast way. And I think that that leads to these types of results, 100% increase in brand lift, 68% lift in brand favorability over that of broadcast TV, and 58% lift in purchase intent. So you're starting to see much better efficacy based upon the fact that they are more targeted and can be more personalized. So like, how do you break through really the static when you're thinking about this? And I'm gonna give you some pointers, some case studies on how to actually go do that. So one, what we at Kargo do is we use the power of what we call creative science. So one, really innovate. How do you start to think about these formats? And I'm gonna show you what those formats look like differently. Two, dynamic driven personalization. So how do you actually introduce into the TV formats things like, oh, it's cold out, so what you wanna show is certain types of ads versus other types of ads. It's raining. You can show, for example, automotive ads do much better when it's raining out than when it's sunny out. Don't know why, but it's almost empirical. And then obviously optimization. How do we leverage sophisticated measurement and data partners to actually allow for the optimization of creatives and targeting that actually drive those better results versus that of sort of just leaving the same thing up on screen for broadcast? So when we look at it, what we've done at Kargo is we've integrated what we call our code, our ad tag, directly into the operating system OS, the advertising OS. And what that allows you to do is serve these beautiful high-impact creatives onto the screen. I'm gonna give you a couple examples of that, and you can hold up your phone and actually see the QR codes, and they will work today with your phone. But it really can sort of change up how and where you show up on the screen itself. So we call it like showstoppers. How do you captivate and activate viewers with a lean forward type of experience? So first impressions count, reaching the consumer early in their CTV experience, grab their undivided attention, and grab the sort of unique real estate that we have access to. And I think that's really the sort of the key takeaway as you start to think about how to reach these users. And when we think about like this kind of activation, we also sort of start to look at how do you actually measure those results. And so we did a study with a company called Realize. And what Realize does is it takes about 800 person panel in homes. And as we put these ad experiences in front of those 800 people, you get a sense of like how they actually react to the ads, how much they can recall those ads, how they actually interact with those ads. And here are sort of the ways that we think about unwrapping the opportunity when we actually ran that study with Realize on how to sort of get the best results from these types of sort of interactive experiences. So let's start with our first unit. We ran this unit with Hershey's called The Wedge. And if you take out your phone, that actual QR code will work on your phone itself and it will pull up a Hershey's page. This wedge unit on the left-hand side sits on that page. It can be interactive, can have a video component to it, and you can actually interact with a coupon or a push to DoorDash or a push to Uber Eats, which I think is pretty exciting when you think about this ending up on your TV screen when you open up your TV in that first page of the operating system. What we saw was 41% of the audience basically stayed or saw that ad for over 10 seconds, which is when we looked at the benchmark and realized was over 21% above the interactive advertising benchmark if you were to run sort of banners or videos on online. So what you're seeing is 21% lift by using this placement because of its nature in terms of owning that screen, on that front screen when you turn on your television set. The second unit, which we call the home screen launcher, sits on that left-hand side. The beautiful thing about this is it can use your existing digital asset. So this is a 300 by 250, the same asset that you would run as a banner on TV. But, I mean, on the open internet, you add a little bit of animation to it. You can add that QR code to it. And again, that QR code is live. And what we saw from that is that you saw an 87% of audience had a positive emotional reaction. So what they said is, is this going to piss you off when you see this, or do you actually think this is something that's accretive or additive to the TV experience? And what are your feelings about it? And when we put that sweetness on the screen and we showed it to them, they actually had positive sentiment around that particular format. This is not a great rendition. I have to show you the animated version, but basically as you're scrolling on the TV, this comes up and sticks to the top, so it doesn't get in the way of content itself, but this is what it looks like. So there's the bottom left, and this sort of scrolls in from the left-hand side. It's a much bigger format, the halo, and it works really well in its sort of interactivity. And again, that QR code works as well. And what we saw is that 55% of respondents recalled Hershey's name and brand after the exposure. So the specific brand, not just the Hershey's brand, but the actual, hey, s'mores, I remember what that product is, when you actually showed that on screen, which is really hard to do when you think about standard interactive ads that you see on the open internet. And then this is the carousel. This was like one of the best units that we showed because it had that interactive creative experience to it. With the QR code that's associated with that. And again, these places can push you to do different things. Where we really want to get to is that just in time, right? Like, hey, it's 5 hours to the big game or 5 hours to Halloween, order your candy right now and have that delivered to your home using sort of the partners. And so it really that prompting of real-time commerce directly off that front screen of the TV set, I think is sort of the future as we start to see it. And people saw with the halo, brand recall and positive sentiment, including, you know, if you look at, and this is specifically for this particular ad that we were showing with s'mores. So we showed that video ad on the left-hand side. It had positive, as you can see, it's people like enjoying the outdoors. They're doing their annual town barbecue with s'mores, and the s'mores truck pulls up, and people felt this sort of super positive sentiment associated with that. And what we saw is 77% of the people that were sitting in front of their TV sets with that particular study in front of them said, oh, they had you know, fun, family, positive experience associated with that s'mores brand product, which I think is pretty powerful. And so when you look at that and you start to think about, well, where exactly in the TV experience do these things show up? What's important is to understand that some of them will show up on that front screen and some of them will show up a little bit deeper in the navigation. In this particular case, this showed up in the apps part of the navigation of the operating system. And when it showed up there, what we saw is that people, because they were in a lean forward, interactive frame of mind, they actually interacted with that unit 3 times greater than standard mobile or desktop units because they were in this sort of lean forward with the remote control, interactive download from the store experience. When you think about that placement in that particular environment, you got and you saw a much better and higher response to actually interact with that unit. Click on it, open it, play a video, open up a shopping experience. And so that was a good sort of understanding or a good lesson for us, which is depending upon where you show up in the operating system and the kind of experience that exists there, you can actually get different types of interaction from consumers because of their state of mind when they're looking at apps. So, you know, how do we be best in class on glass? You know, direct to glass is different from traditional in-stream commercials. New formats require new formulas for success. And here are the 3 best practices that we learned by actually running this particular campaign. One is really designed for the placement. So just like I said previously, if you're in that app download experience, changing the interactivity to actually download or to interact with the ad is much better. So design for that placement. Make it so that you think about each place that it's going to show up and make the design of it really interact with that placement. 2, deploy across multiple channels. So we think that today's current TV advertising where you're just taking your 15 or 30 and running the same thing over and over again with the same creative is not going to be sort of the future of what TV advertising looks like. So deploy different types of TV experiences depending on the channel. So it may be on that LG screen. It may be a 15 that exists actually as you watch your TV show. It may be other interactive units that you can deploy, but the idea is vary things up so that you actually show up with your brand in each of these diversity of different places. And then the last thing, which I think is the most interesting and what makes CTV different, is that you can have these dynamic calls to action, which doesn't exist in broadcast television. So, can you start getting people to shop off of that of the TV screen? Can they either watch a video off of that TV screen? Can they actually take a dynamic action? And what we're seeing for the first time is that people really are leaning in and starting to take those dynamic actions off of these types of formats that sit on the TV screen, where, as you see with traditional 15s and 30-second CTV spots or even broadcast spots, it's really lean back and can you get that brand recall? This is the first opportunity to really get people to lean forward, to interact, and potentially to purchase directly out of that experience. So when we think about the future of TV commerce, you know, these tantalizing these viewers with these products, with these ad experiences, and then allowing these instantaneous gratification experiences in, that is what I think is like the next generation of how you see TV advertising start to display across all these different surfaces, whether it's in the television operating system or whether it's actually in a streaming service like a Netflix or a Paramount Plus, Pluto TV or like a Hulu. What you're gonna start seeing is that you can start to get consumers to start to take an action in those places and start to shop, start to think about driving their next set of activities versus basically just being a branded medium where you just have sort of good experiences or favorability associated with a particular brand. So that in a nutshell is what we're doing. I think it's super interesting when you think about what the future, this is just scratching the surface, it's early days. But what we're seeing is that the results from these consumers as we run these studies, we're getting that level of brand love and favorability and interaction that doesn't really exist when you think about the broadcast medium And that is what we think will drive a lot of the innovation going forward, where people will actually start to lean into connected television because they get that level of targeting that they can't really do in broadcast, because you can start to personalize the ad experience based upon things like weather and geo and segmenting households, and because you can actually start to put these interactive experiences that allow for, you know, using the remote control or a QR code to really start to interact and have the medium of the phone or the computer start to truly interact with the medium that is, you know, the TV set, which has traditionally been a lean back broadcast medium only. So hopefully that is the future. You're starting to see some of the future of what the takeaways are. Love to answer any questions that you guys have, or even have sort of like a interesting sort of pushback or feedback loop on sort of where you think this is going. But would love to get some dialogue going.
Does Kargo have a partnership
with the manufacturers of the CTV apps to sort of make a purchasing account? Or like in this example, when you do the QR code, will it open the partner like Uber Eats? Yeah, so really good question. To repeat the question, does Kargo have the partnerships with folks like the TV manufacturers to enable those commerce-based experiences? What's really funny is that, like, what we found is that we end up being the systems integrator of everything. I don't know why. I think people sort of stick to their swim lanes, and so the TV manufacturer, like, this is great, and the two things that I'm going to do primarily are, one, create a great experience to download an app to install on the TV, and they're really good at that. Tune in, they're really good at. But that sort of systems integration of like, oh, I want to do a deal with Amazon to integrate Buy with Prime so that if your product is in Amazon, you can actually sign into your Prime account and then one-click purchase from inside or the QR code or even maybe even inside the TV set. Typically, companies like Kargo are the ones that actually end up doing that end-to-end integration just because it's a pain in the ass. It's, you know, heavy engineering work. It's a lot of BD work. And when you have an install base of, you know, 700 million TV sets, you don't actually have to work that hard to get the same sort of ROI by just running sort of install ads. It's easier to run around. So we actually end up doing a lot of the innovation around those partnerships, whether it's with Uber Eats, which, you know, is a great example, or DoorDash, whether it's with even working with LG to get the all of that creative was actually done by Kargo. You know, the LG gives you that slice, that slot, but it was our sort of creative studio plus the QR code. You know, we integrated with a partner for the QR code. We actually ended up building the mobile experience with Hershey's, and we were the ones that actually sold this through to Hershey's directly, even though they love the LG folks, you know, because we already run so many campaigns across so many screens with Hershey's already. Marrying this to a mobile campaign that we were already running with them, where there was already allocated budget, and where we already had an annual guarantee with them, we could say this is an innovative extra step that you can take to round out all of your interactive capabilities. And so as they start to think about interactivity on the open web as extending to that of TV sets and to that of desktop and other screens, maybe even in-store or out-of-home screens, they look at us as a way to sort of pull that all together, because we're helping them with sort of that last mile transaction if you were going to sort of do checkout from any number of retailers, or sort of put together the entire brand experience for them using assets that they've already given us. Go ahead. Yeah, so to answer the first question is, what's the advantage of actually being on platform itself, like LG, with ACR data and other data that's made available to you? And then the second question is, like, can you leverage this to actually go a little bit deeper into the apps themselves, the streaming services as an extension? So to answer your first question, right now, other than like maybe California, IP address is still totally viable as a targeting tool, and LG with owning the TV set, even if you're not using IP-specific level targeting at the household level, the idea that you can group those into cohorts of like-minded individuals that are at, even at a zip code level, and you're like, oh, they're all in Beverly Hills, they, you have a certain idea of what their medium household income, their interests. If you go and you look at the driveways, they're pretty much all the same, like two or three cars that sit in all the driveways. So you can start to use that level of cohorts against the specific TV manufacturers where the streaming services or other places like broadcast TV, you don't get anywhere near that level of specificity around the targeting. So I think it's not only do you want to actually use IP address or maybe DMA or those types of targeting, but you can also use, like, is it the latest operating system? Is it the most expensive TV? Because that tells you a little bit about medium household income size. You can leverage all of those assets. The other thing that I think makes the LG TV set so interesting versus any sort of any TV manufacturer is that if people are using that as the front screen to enter the streaming world, so if they're not using an Apple TV box or a Fire box, but they're actually going into that front screen of the LG TV set to access Netflix or to access, you really own that first click when you turn it on. And I think that first front page when you turn on your TV set is extraordinarily valuable from a real estate perspective because it's the first thing that a consumer sees right as they're trying to sort of navigate, take an action, and then get a little bit more passive. And so because you're in a lean forward navigation mindset, I think there's a higher propensity to actually interact with the ads. And that goes back to sort of the learning experience, which is maybe you don't have it as interactive to your point when you get a little bit deeper into the streaming services because you're not going to have that same level of engagement. And maybe the majority of the interaction actually happens on the LG screen because you're in that lean forward interactive navigation headspace when you're interacting with it. But I agree with you. I think the sequencing of ads from inside of the OS at the front screen and then basically using that IP address to effectively, I wouldn't call it retarget, but refine those same households maybe deeper when they're inside the Netflix ad-supported version where you can say, hey, you saw us on the OS and now it's a totally different experience when you're actually in the ad-supported version of Netflix or Pluto or Hulu. That really is the holy grail, right? Like you're pulling together and you're getting at frequency that consumer experience as they migrate or traverse their TV viewing experience. And I think that ultimately allows companies like Kargo, because we work also with the streaming services pretty deeply, and we're working with them on the interactive and on the mobile side, the idea is to pull that into a 360 view of that consumer and really sort of allow for that totally interactive sort of 360 confirmation of that journey of that consumer as you're trying to reach them and have them take an action. Usually what we've seen is it takes at least three different touch points with a consumer to go from, oh, I saw it, to maybe I want to do something about it. And if you don't get those three successive interactions with that consumer, it's very hard for them to actually take an action. But after three, I wouldn't do 10, but after three, you start to get them to say, oh, I do, in the case of Hershey's, I do have a little bit of hunger. I do want a snack. I do want to, and I think our goal is really to enable that sort of instantaneous gratification ultimately. Where, as you're ordering your meal from Uber Eats or from DoorDash or others, you sort of add that, Reese's experience to that larger sort of purchase. And you see that a little bit with the 7-Eleven pop-up. It's like, oh, you ordered from this restaurant, the driver can also go to 7-Eleven and pick up these extra things for you, on their way to your house. I think the ultimate goal for us would be to sort of enable that transaction more seamlessly. Any other questions? Nothing? Well, hopefully you sort of enjoyed what that looks like, gives you a little bit of a vision of like what the future looks like, and hopefully this will be the starting point of driving those kinds of end-to-end integrated experiences on the TV set that will drive sort of the future of what commerce TV looks like. Thanks again.